join together, loving one another, loving you, oh Jesus, love present. You are so good to me, so wonderful your ways. You are so good to me, so wonderful your ways. So lost in your presence, glorifying the name of Jesus with everything that we do and say. We love your presence. Hallelujah. Oh Lord. Oh, together let us praise you. Everyone fitly brought in, joined together, Lord, one unto another in love, Lord, bound together in cords of loving kindness by your Spirit, Lord, entertaining, Lord, even the possibility that we could all come together in complete unity because we're one with you. We acknowledge, Lord, that you have made us one with you. You brought us into your presence, and you've put yourself on the inside of these temples, Lord God, not made, Lord, according to the flesh, but these temples made by the Spirit, that you've made a new man inside of every single one who's raised their hand and called upon you, who's fallen upon their face, who's come to the feet of Jesus and grabbed a hold and said, Lord, I will follow you. I will take everything you give. I will receive it. And Lord, you've done it. You've done it. And everyone who's asked, there is not one excluded. There's no one that you've turned your back on. There's no one that you say, I do not want. There's no one you push aside, Lord, but you've drawn us all together that we might come together with you, joined together in one body by one Spirit to offer up praises unto our God. Lord, this unity of the Spirit that is not something we earn, it's not something we do, it's not something we obtain, it's not something we struggle with, Lord, it's something we receive from you. Lord, I thank you that we can receive from you that glorious anointing of a unity of the body in the bonds of peace. Oh God, to have a people so given over to seeking you, to praying in the Holy Ghost, to waiting upon you, to glorifying you, to speaking praises out, Lord God, clearly opening their mouth and with a shout of praise, declaring to all the world, even if it seems none is listening, declaring to the heavens that you are our God and you have made a way there where there was no way to bring us into unity with you. Oh God, how wonderful it is to receive that which you have given. Amen.
Amen.
Lord, I thank you for that unity in this place. Lord, that all we have to do is choose to receive it. All we have to do is say, Lord, I want to be like you. You said be perfect as your Father in heaven is perfect. And I, instead of hearing that as condemnation and hearing that as, oh my, how am I ever going to do it? I heard it as, yes, I'll take it and I'll run to you. I'm going to be first in line. Lord, I'm going to be there to receive that which you have given freely unto me, unto everyone here that's called upon your name. Father, this place is a house of prayer. Lord, we consecrate it so every time we come in here. It's a place of prayer. It's a place of yielding. It's a place of the Holy Ghost. It's not a place for man to be glorified. It's not a place for man to be heard. Not a place for man to be seen. Lord, we're not even interested one little bit in what any man can do, say, or be. But Lord, we are interested in the revelation of Jesus. Lord, we thank you for the revelation of Jesus in this place tonight as we worship you, as we glorify you. Lord, at this time, we're here gathered together to worship you. Lord, to hear your voice. Lord, to yield unto your spirit. Lord, that you might change those things that need to be changed. And Lord, we all need change. Father, we thank you for a change that's not by the hand of man, not by the tools of man, but the change of the spirit. Lord, every single one, whatever the need, Lord, that you know about, Lord, that you'd minister to it, Lord, that you'd touch it, Father, and they would know they've been touched by heaven as the heavenly anointing comes and touches them and shapes them and molds them and teaches them to yield in places they've not yielded before, to receive healing, to receive strength, to receive financial help, whatever it might be, oh God, Lord, but the word, more than anything else, your word that comes and brings the change. Lord, that we might be representatives on this earth of you. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. I'm so excited. I'm so excited. You can be seated if you want. I am so excited. I am so happy to be here. I am so ready to see God do things above and beyond what we could imagine. I woke up the other morning and I just heard in the spirit, I saw the Father saying, be perfect as your Father in heaven is perfect. And I heard it like I never heard it before. And I saw myself in a dream running, just running. Yes, I'll take it. I'll take it. I'll take it. I'll take it. Just receive it. You just receive it. You say yes. You just say yes. We sing that song, used to sing it a lot more. I say yes, Lord, yes. It's a great one. We're going to say yes to the Lord. Whatever his word says, I'll do it. Whatever his word said, I'll receive it. Whatever his word says, yes, Lord, yes. I'll do whatever you say. This is what we want to do. Now, why? Because do you realize that our God is the most wonderful God you could ever imagine? Amen. He is so far beyond what people think of him as. You know, they think, well, he's created everything and he's all powerful. And they got all these ideas of God. Half of them, the ideas people have are coming from just the philosophies of men. Oh, God's like this because men surmise that he must be like something. Do you realize that he told us exactly what he was like? Yeah. He didn't make it something that you had to wonder about. He declared who he was. We know him as creator. It's true. He is. We know him as Almighty God. It's true. He is. We know him as the one that made Adam, and he made Eve, and he blessed them, and he set them in a beautiful garden, and he gave them everything that was his. He gave it all to them to enjoy. Gave it all to them. Remember, they could eat of anything in the garden. They only had one commandment to avoid, but we won't talk about that right now. He gave them all this good stuff. He did all these. That's the God. We know a little bit about him. But there's a place in Exodus that is one of the most glorious things. It's in Exodus 34. It's one of the most glorious statements about God that you will ever hear. Now, you've heard the story, so I'm going to set it up for you. Moses is up on the mountain with God. And he's had a revelation. It's an intense revelation. He saw God in a bush that burned and did not get consumed. And he stood before God on holy ground, and he was completely broken before the Lord. And God gave him commandment, what he was supposed to do. And he argued with God about, I can't do it, Lord. There's just no way. I can't do it. I can't do it. I can't do it. Sound familiar? Can't do it. The Lord said, I'll take care of that. I'll take care of that one for you. I got that too. I'll fix that. Or I'll give you Aaron for that part. And, you know, whatever. Here, you got a staff. We'll use that. God answered every one of them patiently. Amazing. God is so patient.
And he sent Moses, and Moses did amazing things. You know, and he endured. I mean, Pastor Mark was preaching the other day, and he was talking about what Moses endured when he began to preach the word that God gave him. And every bit of hell came against him. Everything of hell came against him. And it looked like his preaching wasn't making things better. It was making things worse. And the people he was supposed to lead weren't real happy with him. They were really upset with him. But he kept preaching the word God gave him, until they overcame all the powers of darkness. And he led them out with a great salvation. And it's one of the greatest types of salvation that you can ever read. You want to know what you were saved from? It's slavery and bondage and misery and hell, basically, that people live in. And you're saved from that. Saved from that. He brought them out with a mighty hand. And guess what happened as soon as he brought them out? The devil went after him again. And so God stood between them, the powers of darkness manifested by the Egyptian army, and stood between them and the people of Israel. He stood there and he peeked out from the cloud, and then he opened up the sea and they crossed over, and then he destroyed Pharaoh's army. And you know, the Pharaoh that I believe was that Pharaoh, which most people don't realize is that Pharaoh, but that's a whole thing for another day. He has no tomb. It's one of the Pharaohs has no tomb. They can't find a tomb for him. The only thing they've ever found for him is a little shrine on the edge of the Red Sea. Isn't that amazing? They have found a shrine on the edge of the Red Sea that's a little cult of worship, you know, because they worship the Pharaoh, a little cult of worship for that Pharaoh, but he has no tomb. Why? Because he's buried in the Red Sea, because God buried him. Not like the movie where he sits there and gets mad about everything. No, he got buried in the Red Sea with the rest of the people. But God destroyed the enemies of Israel, brought them over, and they followed after God, and there was a cloud over them by day and a fire by night. They had every provision they could need, everything that they could possibly want. And so Moses is up on the mountain, and he's got all this great revelation of God. And he says to God, I want to see your glory. I want to see your glory. And God says, you can't. You'll die, basically. And Moses says, I don't care. I want to see your glory. I want to see your glory. So God makes a plan. He says, okay, here's what I'm going to do. You go hide in the cliff to the rock. I'm going to cover you up. And as I pass by, what's he going to do? He's going to declare the name of the Lord. See, it's who he is. When he declares who he is, his glory shows up. Okay? That's how it's almost like how he turns it on. Because he'd been talking to Moses face to face already, remember? But not in the fullness of his glory. As he goes by Moses, he declares the name of the Lord, and then the glory shows up, such that Moses had to be covered in a veil because he was so shining bright from just the reflection of the glory of God. So we're going to read the name of the Lord. This is amazing. You got to get ready for this. You have to receive this in Jesus' name. It's in Exodus 34. We'll start in verse 5. Now the Lord, he descended in the cloud and stood with him, Moses, there, and proclaimed the name of the Lord. And the Lord passed before him and proclaimed. Here's what he said. You ready for it?
Yeah.
The Lord God, merciful, whoa, and gracious, long-suffering and abounding in goodness and truth, keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin, by no means clearing the guilty, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children and the children's children to the third and fourth generation. That was the name of the Lord. It's a big name. It's who he is. We're going to look at each part of it. It's who he is. This is who God is. The same God who declared that he came to live on the inside of me and on the inside of you, this is who he is. This is who he wants to be in you. We're going to talk about how he wants to be this in you, but let's look at this a little bit first. He says, the Lord God. We said we know him as the creator, the almighty one, the one who made everything, the one who's Lord over all. He is that. He will never cease being that. We will never obtain, we will never be greater than him. We will never be the ones who made anything. We will never do anything that is new to him, because he made everything. He wants to share with us what he made. He wants us to be a part with him in what he made. But he's not going to have us going off doing our own thing. That's not what he's doing. We're sharing with him because he's already made it all. I mean, he's made a universe so big, we can't find the end of it. We keep looking. I mean, I remember in college, I had a big poster on my wall in my dorm room, which was a wall of all the known galaxies. So it had a piece that had like the Earth and the solar system and then where the solar system fit within the Milky Way and where the Milky Way fit within the galaxies. It's pretty wild. That's so outdated. It's so much bigger now. But I used to look at that thinking about how big God was, that he'd made all of that then. And now we look at what we know and that poster would have to fill, you know, 20 times the size to even begin to cover what we know now. And that's not that long ago. I'm not that old. So, what else is he? He's merciful. He's merciful. He is a God who's full of mercy. He is so merciful. What is merciful? Merciful is when you don't hold against people what they've done wrong. That's really what merciful is. That's it. God, this is who he is. He does not hold against people what they've done wrong. That's not what he does. Then it says he's gracious. What is gracious? Very quick to give. People who are gracious are very quick to do for you. Brother, could you move over two seats? I know Mike, he'd move in 3 seconds if I just asked him to do anything. Because he's gracious. He's got the graciousness of God on the inside of him, right? You too. Graciousness is you're just so quick to do what other people ask you to do and what they want you to do. This is God. He's so quick to respond to us when we say, Lord, I need. Lord, I want. Lord, I help. He's so gracious about it. He's long-suffering. Some of us think that he's fed up with us sometimes. Oh, he's just done. You can't, 30 years, still can't get it right. That's not God. He's long-suffering. He bears with us. The only reason God stops working with somebody is when it has been proven beyond any doubt that there is no hope. That's it. He deals with people with long suffering. He will work with you to your last breath. We've all read and heard stories about people who gave their heart to Jesus on their bed right before they died. Tears streaming down their face, crying out, oh God. And I've been involved in a couple of those. And it just wrenches your heart to know the mercy of God is such and his long suffering that he worked with them their entire life to get them to that point. So there was an opportunity. Right. Believe me, he's long suffering. Right. Abounding in goodness and truth. You know, he never does any badness. Amen. Ever. He never does anything wrong. He's abounding in goodness. He never tells a lie. He never deceives. He never tries to, you know, get you off the track. Never. He abounds in goodness and truth. That's all he speaks. He speaks the truth. What's truth? The Word of God is truth. Amen. Jesus said, I am the truth. Yes. Jesus is the Word of God. I tell you, you want to know what truth is? It's the Word of God. It's the Word of God. It's what Jesus quoted from. It's the Word of God. It's truth. It's what we know to be truth. And that's all God abounds in. And he keeps mercy for thousands. I mean, his mercy isn't for one. Pastor Mark talks about the fact that a lot of times he's only got one. But his mercy was for everyone. They just all didn't accept it. Mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin. He'll forgive your iniquity. That means that deep-seated problem inside that the people in the old covenant didn't really get dealt with because the blood that they had, the blood of bulls and goats, could only cover them for the year and make atonement for them looking forward to the day when Christ Jesus would come. And his blood and his sacrifice would bring upon him when all that iniquity was completely removed. Completely removed. Yeah. Mine was completely removed when I got down on my face before God and said, Lord, I'll accept Jesus as my Lord and Savior. And he changed me and made me into a new man. That is when your iniquity gets removed. It's removed. It's no longer there. It's not the devil in me that made me do it, because there ain't no devil left. He took it out. But he also forgives your transgression and your sin. That's when, even though your iniquity's been purged, you err. You make a mistake. You respond after the old man. You do the things that you shouldn't have done, things that you used to do. Or you make a mistake. Guess what happens? We have an advocate with the Father, who's Jesus Christ the righteous. You go to him, and guess what he'll do? He'll forgive. He'll forgive you your transgression and your sin. But then here comes an interesting part. By no means clearing the guilty. He does not ever call sin okay.
Right.
He never does. Not one time has he ever said, you know what? Your sin doesn't matter. Not yours. We're just going to pretend you didn't do it. I'm going to hold yours against you, but not yours against you. That would be diverse weights and measures. God never does that. He never clears the guilty. But he always gives the guilty a way of escape. I can turn to him, cry out to him, and he will forgive me my transgression and my sin, and he will wash me as if I'd never failed. He'll just take it away. That is a loving, merciful, gracious God. This is who he is. It's not something he just decided, hey, I think maybe I'll choose this and try to make everybody bow to this set of rules. No, this is who he is. His very nature, his very being, everything he's given himself to, everything he's created in is this. It is so wonderful. It is so glorious. It is so beyond men's understanding, because everything we watch, everything we read that man writes and makes and produces is all about conflict. It's all about fighting one another and defending yourself and your people and your whatever. And we went to war. It's a righteous war. I've never been a righteous war. I don't care what anybody tells you. There's no righteous wars. There's no righteous wars. Nothing righteous about killing people. Ever. There's a lot of arguments people make. People discuss this and this and what about. And I remember when I was a kid, that was all big on the, you know, if you've got a gun and you could shoot the guy who's holding a gun to your mother and you could shoot him and keep him from killing your mom, would you kill him to prevent you? It's a bunch of nonsense.
Yeah, it is.
Okay? Jesus didn't walk around doing that. Amen. Ever. What did he do? He'd disappear out of their midst. He'd command them. He said, he showed his power when they came to get him in the garden. He said, I am. They all fell down. That's how God does it. There are no righteous wars. But anyway, I digress a bit. But no means does he clear the guilty. He visits the iniquity of the fathers upon the children and the children's children to the third and fourth generation. You could imagine that it would be possible that if some man lived his whole life without sin and had a child who lived his whole life without sin and had a child who lived his whole life without sin who and had a child who lived his whole life without sin, they might have a perfect child. Really, if you take the scripture and you look at it literally, I guess it would be conceivably, theoretically possible. But never happened. Why didn't it happen? Because of the sin of Adam passed upon all men, it says in Romans, so that all have sinned. Because of the iniquity that passed from Adam to all of his descendants, then all men sinned. Now we've been made righteous, but we've been made righteous not because we lived a perfect life, but because Jesus lived a perfect life. And he gave his perfect life to me, so I've received it. Right? The fact that the iniquity passes from child to child to everyone who's born is born with the same problem. Everyone born of the flesh is flesh. But they that are born of the Spirit are spirit. I'm spirit.
Yeah.
I have received the new birth. I have received the glorious salvation of my God that has caused me to walk in heavenly places with him. It is a great and glorious manifestation of God. So this is the name of the Lord. This is who he is. And this is who is now living on the inside of me. And I shouldn't in this place have to prove that to you, because we've heard it so many times. We don't have to talk about it right now. If you need to know more about it, you can listen to just about any service in the last, 30 years, and you will hear defenses and clarity of the truth being spoken. But we know, and have received the life of Jesus on the inside of me. He said, I will come and make my dwelling with you. He comes and makes his dwelling with me. He puts on the inside of me a new man, a new spirit, and puts his spirit on the inside of me. And he and the Father come together and they come dwell in me. And then they gave me of their spirit, gave me the Holy Spirit, the third member of the Trinity. They gave me the Holy Spirit that I might dwell and walk in him. I mean, I'm pretty much covered. This is what we've received. So let's turn to Psalms 145. So this morning, I'm dwelling on these things. And I wake up to my wife reading out loud in the Bible. And this is what I heard. It's verse 8 of Psalms 145. The Lord is gracious and full of compassion, slow to anger, and great in mercy. The Lord is good to all, and his tender mercies are over all his works. It's another testimony, a second witness, as who he is. This is who he is. He's gracious, full of love and compassion. He's very slow to anger, very long-suffering, in other words. And he is great. He's merciful. He's great in mercy. He's good to all. He's so good. This is who he is. Now, I've received of him his very life on the inside of me. Guess what I am? I'm all these things. Everything we just read about God, he's put on the inside of me. This is what he's made me to be by his life. This is what he desires me to manifest in every dealing I have with anybody, anywhere, at any time. And it begins in this place where he says to all of us, love one another, even as I have loved you. He brings us together. And he tells us that we need to pursue the unity of the Spirit, the bond of peace, because we're all in this together. We're all family. We've been brought into this local manifestation of the family of God that is universal. And in this local manifestation, we love one another. It's the first thing he asks us to do. You begin by loving one another. Love one another, even as I have loved you. He's telling us, manifest my life in you, one unto another. That's what he's saying. This is what you want to do. So let's turn to Matthew 18, because I'm going to get you a little bit more now. There's an incredible testimony in Matthew 18 of what it means to forgive. And you know the parable, you should know, but I'm going to start in verse 21, because we're going to read this thing. And we're going to understand something about what God's asking us to do. And Peter came to him and said, Lord, how often shall my brother sin against me and I forgive him? Up to seven times? Will seven times do? Jesus said to him, I do not say to you up to seven times, but up to 70 times seven. Really meaning as long as it takes. As many times as you need to. It just never ends. Therefore, he says, I'm going to teach you. Let me speak a parable to you that speaks to this issue, because I'm going to teach you something. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven is like a certain king who wanted to settle accounts with his servants. You know, his ledger was, a little off, and he just wanted to get everything settled. So he calls in his servants. And when he had begun to settle accounts, one was brought to him who owed him 10,000 talents. That's a lot of money, okay? I mean, that's a debt you cannot pay. That's more than your mortgage. That's more than your college bills. That's more than your cars. That's more than anything you could imagine. That's running up a huge bill. Just think of it that way, rather than trying to figure out how many talents, what's that, 2015 money and blah, blah, blah. The long and the short of it is, it's more than you could ever pay. He owed him 10,000 talents. But he was not able to pay. His master commanded that he be sold with his wife and children and everything that he had, and that payment be made. This was a very common way that used to handle debt. In fact, many of our ancestors who came to America came as indentured servants. That means they had debts in Europe they couldn't pay, so they sold themselves as an indentured servant and got sent over here on a boat to work for a number of years until they worked off their debt. Okay? It was a very common way to do these things. The servant, therefore, fell down before him, saying, "Master, have patience with me, and I will pay you all." What's he asking for? He's asking for mercy. Have mercy upon me. Then the master of that servant was moved with compassion. See, that's God. He's full of love and compassion. So he was moved with compassion. Released him. Not only did he say, "I'll give you more time to pay." He could have done that, because that's really all the servant asked for. "Just be patient with me. I'll pay it all." And the master said, not only did he release him, but he forgave him the debt. That's intense. He just wiped it clean, cleared his ledger up. Done. But that servant went out. Immediately upon this happening to him, he goes out and he finds one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 denarii. I mean, you drop that on the ground and don't bother to pick it up. Just think of it that way. It's very little, certainly in comparison to 10,000 talents. You're going from massive number to tiny little number. And laid his hands on him, took him by the throat, saying, "Pay me what you owe." Notice, he didn't just say, "You know, look, I think you owe me 100 denarii. I think we need to clear this up." This is what the king did to him. He really got angry with him. He grabbed him by the throat. "You owe me. Give it to me." So his fellow servant fell down at his feet and begged him, saying, "Have patience with me, and I will pay you all." Does that sound familiar? He says the exact same thing. Wow. And he would not. But he went and threw him into prison till he should pay the debt. Isn't that amazing? Why would he do that? So when his fellow servants saw what he had been done, they were very grieved. And they came and told their master all that had been done. So somebody went and said, "You know, you just forgave this guy and look what he just did." Then his master, after he had called him, said to him, "You wicked servant, I forgave you all that debt because you begged me. Should you not also have had compassion on your fellow servant, just as I had pity on you?" And his master was angry, delivered him to the torturers until he should pay all that was due to him. Isn't that amazing? So, here's Jesus. "My heavenly Father also will do to you if each of you from his heart does not forgive his brother his trespasses." Wow. Yeah. What is God asking us to do? Exactly what he would do. Amen. He's asking us to be like him, to be forgiving, to be loving. Your brother says to you, "I can't pay you back." Forgiven. Why? Because you're so great? No, because that's what God did for you. He did more than that for you. He forgave you everything. He forgave your sin, your iniquity he wiped away. He's forgiven you that which you could never pay, that which would destroy your life. And all he's asking you to do is forgive men their trespasses against you. They can't even do that much to you. What could they do? Kill your body? Jesus testified to us that, look, don't fear them that can kill the body, but fear him that can not only kill your body, but can take your soul and cast it into hell. That's one you need to fear. Yes. So people look at this and go, "Oh, you know, I got to forgive my brother." But we just got finished telling you over here that God is the one who does all this, and he's put his life on the inside of you. It's not hard to forgive your brother, your sister. It's not hard to have them mistreat you, do that which is wrong, say something evil against you, even falsely, and you forgive them. You forgive them. Every trespass, you forgive. There are times God will tell you, go make it right, go make restitution. Why? For your sake? Sometimes you need to do it for your sake. Sometimes you need to do it for their sake. They need to see it. It doesn't matter why you should just do it. Yes. Because that's who God is. When God declared his name, this is the one thing that he declared more than anything else. Merciful, compassionate, gracious, forgiving. This is who he is. But he will never call sin right. He will always make it right. How does he make it right? The blood of Christ. So how could we not spend our life praising the one who has made everything right? The king forgave the debt, wiped it out. Jesus came, wiped our debt out, took care of it. We had a debt of sin that we had to pay, and there's only one payment for it. What is the wages of sin?
Death.
He paid it for me. And not only did he pay it for me, he paid it for you. And not only did he pay it for me and you, he paid it for every single person who will call upon his name. He has made a way for anybody who will choose him. And if you choose him, he will put his life on the inside of you. And guess what that life is? Merciful.
Yes.
Compassionate.
Yes.
Loving.
Amen.
This is who he is and who I am because he made me that way. This is the testimony of being in Christ. I'm in him. Therefore, I have what he has. What does he have? The life of God. What is the life of God? It's this. Now, how much more should we forgive these little teeny trespasses, little minor things that people do? They yell at us. They say something bad about us. They tell a joke at our expense. None of these should they do. There's even worse things people might do to you. I'm sure every one of us, if we tried hard, could think about something where somebody really mistreated you at some time in your life. It doesn't even, it's 100 denarii compared to 10,000 talents. It is completely worthless to even think about it. You don't need to consider how somebody mistreated you. You need to consider how you forgave them. Now, should you be the one mistreating? Then go plead for forgiveness. We shouldn't be that either. But really, all that's been taken out of us. God's people aren't the ones out oppressing people and mistreating people. They're just not. You find people doing that, they're not God's people. But I'll tell you what God's people definitely are. They're the ones forgiving people for doing those things. They're the ones blessing people and not cursing them, even when they seemingly deserve to be cursed. He even wants us to forgive the ISIS guys. He wants us to forgive everyone who has mistreated us. He wants to forgive the one who flew into the, you know, who helped the other guys fly into the World Trade Center. He wants us to forgive them. We don't, you know, in America, we don't like to hear that. We struggle with it a little bit because it's like, well, that was awful. That was me. That was terrible. They killed a lot of people. They did. And it was awful. And it was bad. It was really bad. But God wants us to forgive even our enemies. He wants us to love even our enemies. Well, where do we start? As Pastor Mark likes to say, two hands for beginners. Love one another. Forgive one another. If I'm struggling with forgiving you when you step on my foot, I'm not going to be very good at forgiving my enemies. Right?
Yep.
So we need to do these things. I can live the life of God. Now, how do I receive this life? Because if I then go out and say, okay, I've got to remember how to do this. What was it God was? Oh, he's compassionate, he's merciful. And if I'm struggling to do this, I'm not going to be very successful. Because I'm relying on what? I'm relying on the flesh. I'm relying on my natural mind. I'm relying on my physical ability or my memory or whatever else it might be. We don't want to rely on that. So what needs to happen if I want to live the life of God? It has to flow up out of my belly. Out of my innermost being comes the life of God by the Holy Ghost. And that life begins to bubble up. And out of that bubble up comes the speaking in tongues, comes the interpretation, comes the prophecy, comes the strength. I tell you what, when it's bubbling up out of you and you hear the word of God coming up out of your mouth saying forgive, saying compassion, saying mercy, the word of God is coming, you're not going to have any trouble doing it. I can tell you that's true. Now, when you try to remember how to do it and try to do it right and convince somebody, you're just lost. You're going to fall apart. I mean, good on you for trying, but it ain't going to happen. But when you go to prayer, when you yield yourself to the Holy Ghost, you say, Lord, come do it in me. Fill me up with your compassion. Fill me up with your love. Fill me up with your mercy. Fill me up with your joy. Fill me up with all good things. I tell you what, it becomes very easy to forgive. Very easy. So that, you know, if you forgive somebody $1 million, it's nothing. You forgive somebody for doing some awful thing, it's nothing. It becomes easy because you know the one who forgave you. I know him. How do I know him? Because he revealed himself to me. How did he reveal himself to me? By the Spirit. By the Spirit. Let's look at Ephesians. Oh, Father, you're so good. So wonderful. Lord, I thank you now, Lord, that everyone in this place who does not know you like this, Lord, I ask you now to penetrate their heart. Touch them with that mercy and compassion, Lord, that you have. That same mercy and compassion that touched me that day so many years ago when you touched my life and said, I'll forgive you. I'll make you right. I'll clean you up. I'll take away all your sin. And I heard it and I believed it by the Spirit and I was changed. This is the new birth miracle. So in chapter 1 of Ephesians, oh man, how do you break in?
Praise the Lord.
I'll tell you guys a secret. Yeah. You guys want to hear no secret? I just finished with my son David. We recorded all of Ephesians, for the translation that Dr. Pastor Mark Spitzbergen did. He doesn't know this, so don't tell him.
Too late.
But we just finished recording it, so we're post-producing at the moment. And because I just wanted to do it. And what's that? Yeah, I know. I know. And I tell you, what a glorious experience to read the Word of God. And we had to go over parts and do parts again. And you know, we did a thing. But it just gets in you. You're speaking it out. It's so wonderful. The book of Ephesians is amazing. And if you haven't spent some time reading what he did, I mean, by the Holy Ghost, over, I know it's been a number of years, he has been working on a lot of things, but Ephesians, he's translated it directly from the original Greek and put footnotes, and it's all on the web, and it's free. All you have to do is go there and download it, and it's absolutely amazing. You want to know the doctrine of God? It's all there, and more. It's amazing. But in chapter 1 of Ephesians, there comes this, I mean, this glorious testimony. This is Paul's opening statement, basically. He's just talking about it. You'll see that Ephesians, it sort of builds as he does this. And here's Paul by the Holy Ghost saying this. And I just got to go back to verse 3. I'm really trying to get to verse 7, but verse 3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who's blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ. Wow. That's a lot. Just as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love. Remember what we're talking about? In love. Holy and without blame in love. Love one another. Ooh. Having predestined us to adoption as sons by Jesus Christ to himself, according to the good pleasure of his will, to the praise of the glory of his grace. What is his grace? Excuse me. His grace is him empowering us to do everything that's like him. That's really what grace is. So when he says, to the praise of the glory of his grace, it's not that we're going to do all these things to the praise of how well I did. I did such a good job. Aren't you guys all proud of me? That's not it. It's this, to the praise of the glory of his grace, the good pleasure of his wills, to the praise of the glory of his grace by which he made us accepted in the beloved. He did that. He took me when I was unacceptable, dirty, ugly, stinky, bad. And he cleaned me up and made me right and brought me and joined me with the rest of you in this place of love. He joined us in this body. In him, so here's what we wanted to get, verse 7. In him, in Christ Jesus, in him, not in me, other than the fact that he's in me, but in him, we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, according to the riches of his grace, which he made to abound toward us in all wisdom and prudence. He did that. He gave me all of his wisdom, all of his understanding. He put it on the inside of me. He did that. I didn't do that. I didn't obtain that. I didn't earn that. I didn't figure it out. I didn't sit down in philosophy class and come up with a new way of thinking that just revolutionized the way that we ought to understand things. No, he declared it. He did it. He gave it to me freely, like everybody's going to give and receive gifts in a couple of days. And we do that. It's our tradition. And, you know, everybody knows what I'm talking about. So, you know, you go and you get a present, you open it up, and you receive the present. You go, thank you. That's so wonderful. Thank you for thinking of me, et cetera, right? We give. God gave me that. He gave me a gift. But this is so great, it cannot be contained in this earth. It's so big. It is the most amazing gift you could ever receive. And he did that, but notice what it's consistent with. It's consistent with his testimony of who he is. Forgiveness of sins. Remember, he forgives. He takes away your iniquity and forgives your sin. And forgives your transgressions. He does that. He's forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace. He's done that. It's amazing. That's salvation. If you've not called upon the name of the Lord Jesus for salvation, you're missing out. He has given us love and compassion that is so far beyond what man can do. He has given unto us mercy like he has, so that we can be merciful one to another. I remember being very impacted in college. It's just one of those things that I've never been able to forget. Because, I mean, if you don't know the history, I barely got saved before I went to college. I'd just gotten saved. I didn't know anything. I knew nothing about God, very, very little. I went to college, and I'm seeking after God. That's how I ended up where I ended up. And I met my friends there that God joined me with, and we've been together ever since. In this place. And God did all of that. I didn't do that. It was not my plan. He did that. And I remember hearing a testimony that somebody gave about how these guys kept preaching to him and he didn't want to hear it. And they kept preaching to him and he didn't want to hear it. And then one day he got upset with him, so he turned around and hit one of them and pushed another one. And the guy fell down and caught the edge of his nose on the table, hit his nose, like ripped his nose half off his face, blood pouring out everywhere. Disgusting, whatever. And the guy's kind of shocked because he just did this to this guy. And he's like, ah! And the guy looks at him, it's all right. Jesus did more for you than I could ever do. And that guy got so impacted by that he fell down on his knees and gave his heart to Jesus. And I have never forgotten that in all these years, that story, because it reminded me of how much we ought to lay down our lives for one another and for those that are without. We would die to see people come into the kingdom. And many have. People have shed their blood just like Jesus did, just like the apostles did, just like the martyrs did all throughout history, shed their blood to see people come into the kingdom. Would we shed our blood? Would we lay down our life? Well, you know where you begin to learn how to flow in the Holy Ghost to that point? By loving one another. We just love one another. We can start there. That's a good place to start. Just love one another. But in him, we've received this same life. Let's look at one more in Ephesians, just because it's so great. In chapter 3. Here we go. Verse 8, chapter 3. Paul says to me, who am less than the least of all the saints, this grace was given. What grace was given to him? He was given an empowerment by God to do something. Excuse me. That I should preach among the Gentiles the unsearchable. We were struggling with this word in Pastor Mark's translation, unfathomable. It's a tough word to say in the midst of a sentence, let me tell you. unsearchable riches of Christ, something you cannot even understand, the riches of all that is in Christ. You just can't. And to make everyone to see what is the fellowship of the mystery, which from the beginning of the ages has been hidden of God, in God, who created all things through Jesus Christ, to the intent that now the manifold wisdom of God might be made known by the church to the principalities and powers in the heavenly places, according to the eternal purpose which he accomplished in Christ Jesus our Lord. That's telling us that this forgiveness that I'm talking about, this living the life of Christ Jesus out through your belly, out through the Holy, by the Holy Spirit in your life, is not just for you. It's not just for us. It's not even just for all the people out there that need to hear this wonderful gospel. It's for the heavens. It's the declaration of who God is. Now take that, who he is. He is this. He is loving and compassionate and merciful, forgiving, all of these things. That's who he is. And he wants us to live his life, doing what he would do on this earth. And he's given us a training ground. Love one another. Isn't that great? He's so merciful to us as we learn to be merciful to one another. And I said the word learn, but I got checked there a little bit. I want you to hear something. When we talk this way and we talk about these things, this is not an academic exercise. It's not what it is. We can sit in a classroom and talk about academic things and discuss how we line stuff up and do all, we can do all that. But it won't change one person. But by the Spirit, the Word of God speaking forth by the Spirit will touch the heart and will change a person. All they have to do is be willing to change. All they have to do is say, yes, Lord, I want your way. All they have to do is call upon his name. And Father, I thank you that your Word does not go forth void, but that everyone who hears it, Lord, cannot be released from that word bombarding them with you knocking at the door of their heart saying, come unto me and I will give you rest. Lord, I thank you for it in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, Holy Ghost. They can't get away from it. This word of God that is not an academic exercise goes forth and changes you. You sit down and read it, you pray it, you speak it out, it changes you. It makes you different because you begin to flow in it. You begin to live in it. You begin to do it. It becomes the manifestation of who you are because you walk in the Spirit. This is why Pastor Mark's always pleading to us. Listen, pray in the Holy Ghost before you come to church. Simple request. It's a simple request. Just do it. Why? Because he knows it'll be good for you. He knows that it will change you. You being obedient and giving yourself to what God said will bring change in your life because it'll be by the Spirit. When you're sitting there yielding to the Holy Ghost, praying in the Holy Ghost, God's doing stuff you can't even understand. And if you can't pray in the Holy Ghost, you say, look, I really haven't received the baptism of the Holy Ghost. I really don't know how to pray in the Holy Ghost. All you have to do is ask. You just ask him. You say, Lord, give me the Holy Ghost. And he said that he is so loving and merciful that if we ask for him a piece of bread, that he'll throw rocks at us. No. He said he'd never give us a rock instead of a piece of bread. You'd never give a serpent instead of an egg. You wouldn't do that. How much more will he give the Holy Ghost, whoever asks him? How much more? This loving, compassionate God, you ask him for the Holy Ghost, guess what you'll get? Holy Ghost. That's all I have to do. It's just that simple, and you can receive it. And then up out of your belly flows this river of the Holy Ghost, and it changes you. Why? Because you need to be made righteous? No, you already been made righteous. Because you need to learn how to yield.
That's right.
You just need to learn how to yield. You need to grow. And it grows you. It fashions you. It makes you usable for the purposes. Because he wants to do like he did to Paul and give you a grace to do something in the kingdom. And it may start with just forgiving your brother. It may start with just being very quick to forgive somebody who loves you. Just start there. And you say, oh, Lord, let that forgiveness flow. Then he'll take you as that begins to get stronger in your life. He'll take you to where you begin to forgive people for bigger things. And then you begin to forgive for even really big things. And then you just have forgiveness flowing out of you all the time. So, Father, we thank you. Father, we thank you, Lord, for the manifestation of the Holy Ghost. Father, we thank you for the presence, Lord, that you've given unto us. Lord, we thank you for the bubbling up out of the belly. Lord, this flow of the Holy Ghost that's only going to get stronger in those who yield to it. Lord, that's only going to get greater in those who will receive it. It's only going to be more effective in those who allow you to flow in them more than they've ever done before. Who will give themselves, Lord, to yielding to the Holy Ghost. Lord, this power that you work on the inside of us, this greatness that you have given unto us, Father, that you have done, Lord, so that your people be so desirous to be in your presence every day, every moment, saying, Lord, let your presence be manifested in my life. Lord, praying in the Holy Ghost, giving themselves to the love of God, yielding themselves, Lord, to your power, your mighty strength, your mighty power, yielded to it. Lord God, that you would do mighty things through us, Lord, to the people around us. So that we would come together in this place, in the unity of the Spirit, in the bond of peace, every time we meet together. Every time. This month, or the next month, no, this month, last day of this month, New Year's Eve, we'll be having a special service here.
Praise God.
Come. It's one of those wonderful times that we have where we join together and there's a specific purpose to just pray over the new year coming. Is it because that particular day is more important than any other day? Not necessarily, but in our calendar that we use, it's setting up 2016, and God, when we make an appointment to meet him over the coming year, he comes and meets with us.
Hallelujah.
And there'll be a declaration of his word and a declaration of the Spirit that will make a difference in your life, and it will give us direction on things that need to be changed and things we need to do different in the coming year. And they won't be New Year's resolutions where you're saying, by my own help and strength, I'm going to do a better job of X, Y, or Z. It ain't going to be that. It's going to be an impartation of the Spirit that's going to do something in your life that if you'll yield to it, it will bring great fruit throughout that year and in the years beyond,
yeah,
as long as we're here waiting,
yeah,
and watching for when we're going to be taken away with him, whether by the grave or by the catching away or whatever it might be. We're going to be watching continuously. Lord, what do you want me to do today? Lord, where do you want me to go today? What do you want to do in my life today? And there's an impartation to be given to you and to me that the Holy Ghost has made an appointment to give by his Spirit, so you don't want to miss it. So be here for that. So that's a sidelight. But Father, we thank you that tonight the word has gone forth to change your people, to bring them to a place where they can yield to you more than they've ever yielded to you before, that they can hear the voice of the Holy Ghost saying to them, yield to me, come to me, ask of me, saying to you, let me reveal Jesus in your life. And it can begin with you seeing the manifestation of God in your life to forgive. The manifestation of God in your life to forgive men their trespasses against you. That is an amazing manifestation of God. That is not a manifestation of the flesh. That is not a manifestation of your ability. That's a manifestation of God. You can rejoice in, Lord, I forgave him. I'm so happy to see the manifestation of God in my life. You know, it's really that good. It's just like running to him, running. Lord, I want everything you got. I want to be perfect like you're perfect. I want to be filled with all the goodness that's in you. Lord, I want to be so manifesting Jesus in everything I do that men just can't deal with me. They'll have to kill me or exile me or whatever might have to happen just because they won't be able to deal with it. I mean, isn't that a great thing to want from God? I want that from God. Do that for me. Lord, do that in me. Make me so annoying to men they can't put up with me, so they must fall down on their face and say, of a truth, the Spirit of God is in you. And they repent or they have to kill me. One or the other. Either way, it's good for me. Amen. So, Father, we thank you, Lord, for a holy desire in every one of your people.
Hallelujah.
Lord, an impartation of a holy desire in every one of your people. Everyone who's called upon you. Lord, an impartation of a holy desire. A holy desire to manifest the love of God like never before, in a greater way than ever before. Lord, it's not condemnation. There's no condemnation in it. It's simply an offer. Here's a gift. Here it is. I'm giving you the best gift you could possibly receive for Christmas. I'm giving it to you and I'm saying, take it. It's yours. You can have the life of God manifested in you. In Jesus' name. Father. Lord, every need in this place. Lord, every need, whatever it might be, every need met. Whatever it is, just cry out to God. Lift your hands to heaven. Lift your hands to receive. Just whatever it might be. Lord, I thank you that every need by your Spirit is met. Lord, there's not one need here that you do not understand, that you do not know, and Lord, you meet it. Father, I ask you to make us ministers of your gospel by your grace, that good news of every need is met, that Lord, use us to meet those needs. Lord, let the bowels of compassion rise up inside of us, that Lord, we might see somebody has need and we might bring the ministry to that need, whatever it might be. In Jesus' name. Lord, I thank you, Lord, that you are so faithful, that you're so long-suffering, that you're so merciful, that you're so full of compassion. Lord, that you do, when we ask, you come and you answer right away. When we ask you to forgive us, you forgive us right away. Lord, when we come and say, fill me with Jesus, you come and fill us with your very life. And when we say, give me the Holy Ghost, you come and give us the Holy Ghost. In Jesus' name, amen. If there's anybody in here and you want to receive the life of Christ Jesus, and you're not certain that you've been changed and you've been given a spirit different than the one you were born with, that you're not certain that you've been given a life different than the one you were born with, and you're not certain you've been set free from all the bondages of sin and all have been wiped away and been given a brand new, faith-filled, love-filled, righteousness-filled life, please, right now, just say, Jesus, fill me up. You can come up here. We'll pray with you. We'll minister to you by the Holy Ghost, and we'll see a change come. The greatest miracle is the miracle of salvation. If there's anybody else who needs any prayer, you can come. We'll pray with you. We'll minister with you. We'll join our faith up with yours, so you feel free to come. Don't forsake your giving. Don't forsake your honoring God with your tithes and with your offerings. Just do it reverently in worship, giving unto the Lord. And reverently and in worship, you can hug one another, bless one another, pray for one another. Be mindful of the Holy Ghost and all of it. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Thank you.
Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Father, for the Holy Ghost and fire. We thank you, Jesus, for what you are doing in the midst of your people. Father, we thank you that you are doing what only you can do. Only you can do through your people. Father, we thank you for what you've done in 2015 through the people that have allowed you to have your perfect work done in them. You know how you can do great and mighty things in God. It's very simple. You yield yourself to the Holy Ghost. And you say, here I am, Lord, through thick and thin, no matter what goes on, no matter what comes, no matter what goes, and I'll be here and I'll do, Father, whatever you ask me to do. I'll be whatever you ask me to be. Lord Jesus, I'm not running to the chicken shed when things get tough. I'm not going and I'm not hiding out. I'm not looking for a way around the mountain. I'm looking for a way through whatever you place before me. And you know how you can know that you're in the right place at the right time? When things look like they're pretty tough and they don't seem like they're going right, and you may be in the middle of a battle that you can't comprehend why you're there. You know how you know that you're in the right place? Because you're there. God's brought you here to bring you to the next place in Him. Now, you could have got yourself there by not listening, but you know what? You're there. And you're going to go through it and listen to get to the next place in God. Now, I want to say that again. You may have got yourself there through not listening, but you're not going to get to the next place in God until you go through it. You're not going around it. You can wander in the wilderness for 40 years around the same mountain, but you're going to go through it the right way if you're going to go to the next place in God. And every person that is saying, oh God, not my way, but your way. Not my will, but your will. Not how I figure it out, but how you're doing it. I surrender myself to you, O Lord, for your purposes and your eternal plans right now in my life. Then you go to the next place in God. Then you begin to be more of a partaker of heavenly things as you surrender and you yield yourself up. And I know that there's several people in this place that God has just launched them into another place. They've received more in God in 2015. But get ready, get ready, get ready. 2016 is a very important year for everybody in the body of Christ. And I tell you what, you want to be in the position of saying, not my will, but yours, Lord. Teach me and prepare me for the years to come. Because this country and the people in this country are getting ready to go through some intense things. And you want to be prepared to be on the forefront. You want to be prepared to be there, used mightily of God, not sitting back there in the chicken coop, not wanting to come out the door. You want to be prepared for what God has for you. And the only way you can be prepared is surrender yourself and say, I'm going through it. I'm doing it the right way, God. I'm not doing it my way. And I don't care if it puts me on my face before you day and night. Lord, I'm going your way. I'm surrendering myself to you and I'm walking my life out for your will. I'm not going to get snared and deceived and caught up by the cares and the riches and the pleasures of this world. I'm not going to allow myself to be allured over into these things. But Lord, I'm going to get over here in the quiet place, in the secret place. And I'm going to seek your face, oh God. I'm going to seek your face, oh God. And I'm going to let all the pride, and I'm going to let all the selfishness, and I'm going to let all the self-exaltation go. And I'm going to say, Father, I want nothing but you and me. Nothing but you, Lord. Nothing. No matter what it costs. No matter what it costs. No matter what it costs. And that's why most people are in this place tonight, is because you're a people that's saying, look, God, I want to be real with you. I want to be real with you. Don't forget why you're sitting in a place where the light shines and the darkness has to flee. Don't forget while you're sitting here what you're here for. You're here to give it all to Him, not to live your own life. Because I tell you what, this world and this life is so ran by the powers of darkness because the majority of the world has given themselves over, and that brings a powerful atmosphere that people that don't know the power of God so come under so quickly. And the people that know the power of God should not come under. And you will not come under when you're giving yourself over to the Holy Ghost. But if you're not allowing the Holy Ghost to have His way, if you're thinking that everything you do, these things are okay because this is how the world is and this is how it is today and this is 2015 and, you know, we've been set free to live like we live now. We need to look at the past to understand the present and the future. God is a holy God and He has not changed. God is a righteous God and He has not changed. God is a God that requires us to be like Him, not like the world. And so many of God's people are forming and fashioning themselves after this world. And I don't care who does it. Our eyes are supposed to be on Him. On the holy, mighty, righteous, pure, almighty God. And we're to be so sensitive to what the Holy Spirit's saying. And like Pastor Mark said the other night, if the Holy Spirit isn't doing it, then we have no business doing it. If the Holy Spirit isn't saying it, then we have no business saying it. If the Holy Ghost isn't going there, we have no business going there. If the Holy Ghost isn't wearing it, we don't have no business either. All the way around, it's about Him. And the church better take a hold of that. And I tell you what, people, as we bind together and we take a hold of what God's saying in the spirit of unity, we'll see this nation changed. Just as many people, it doesn't matter if it's by many or if it's by few. If we will come together and we will take a hold of what God says and not have our own ideas and our own purposes and our own plans in it, God can do mighty things through a few people that will stand together with one heart, one mind. Going after the things of the kingdom of God. Giving themselves to be like Jesus. I had no intentions to get up here, but hallelujah, to say all of this. I just wanted to say, Thursday night, a week from tomorrow night, Pastor Mark wanted me to announce to you that there will be a service here in this place as we're preparing to go into 2016. It's a year of preparation. It's a year of preparation. It's a year you better not be sitting on your hands. It's a year that you want to run after God like you've never run after Him before. It's a year that you want to say, look, enough of the sleep and the slumber. I must awaken. Watch and pray. That means watch, means don't be sleeping. Forget about sleep. Don't allow yourself to be asleep spiritually. Don't allow yourself to be careless with the things of the Spirit. Watch and pray. Watch and pray. Watch and pray that you may be able to escape all these things that are coming upon the earth. Get ready. Get ready. Now, if there's anybody in this place that you haven't surrendered your life to Jesus Christ, we want to give you the opportunity again because Father is calling you. Today is the day of salvation, not tomorrow, not sometime in the future. Today. Today is the day. He brought you here for this time, for this purpose, because of His plan for your life. He brought you here and He said, now. Now is the time. Now is the time to come to Him. He is a good and a loving God, but He brought you to this place in this moment right now that you could come to Him. And if you've been playing around on God, you know Him and you've been playing around on God, God brought you here right now to this time and this purpose. And He's calling you to come back to Him. He's calling you to no more slumber and sleep and walk in your own way, he's calling you to come right now to Jesus. Come to Jesus. Come to Jesus. He's calling you. 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 Anyone that wants prayer for anything in this place, again, I'm going to give you the opportunity to come and we'll pray for you. And if you don't know the Lord Jesus Christ, we want you to come too, because we want you to receive this glorious, wonderful gift that he has given us, eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. This life is only but for a moment in time compared to all eternity. And you don't want to prepare your life for a temporal man, this body that is going to live for a very short period and die very soon. You don't want to give all of your lifetime preparing for you in a natural state. You want to give yourself preparing for your eternal state. And he's calling you to come and prepare for your eternal state. He's calling for you to come and prepare for your home in heaven for all eternity to live with him. He would not want not one person in this place to spend eternity with Satan in hell, with the deceiver, with the one that has come to try to drag as many people on his side against the Almighty God as he possibly can. God is calling you to come to him, to spend eternity with him, so he can bless you and give you all of heaven. Not only after this life, but in this life now, that you can live in the realms of glory and you can live in the realms of heaven. And it doesn't matter what you go through, you're living in the realms of heaven because you're allowing yourself to be given over to him. The only time that it's tough and it's hard is when you're hanging on to your life. When you let go, it's easy. You can count it all joy because you're letting go of your life and you're giving it all to him. Hallelujah. Anybody that wants prayer, I want to tell you again, come now and we'll pray for you. Otherwise, I will dismiss the service. But I would ask you, if there's people here that we're praying for, I'd ask you not to have fellowship down here, but to go ahead and go upstairs if you want a fellowship. Otherwise, you can pray with me as I'm praying for the people that come. You hook up with what the Holy Ghost is doing. We need to remember. We need to encourage and exhort each other every day that we stay focused on the things of the Spirit. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. We praise you, Father, for your goodness. We thank you, Father, that you break every yoke and every lie of the enemy, every bit of bondage off of the lives of these people. Father, that you bring the change, Father, that you bring the change in their life. Father, you do what only you can do. Father, we have no ability to do it in and of ourselves, but Father, we have the power of all of heaven on the inside of us to see the change as we pray as your ambassadors of heaven. Father, yes. To see the chains broken off, to see people set free, to see them healed and delivered by the power of the Almighty. Hallelujah. We thank you, Father, for your glory. We thank you, Father, for your anointing. We thank you, Father, that you break every yoke off of every person in this place. Lord, those that are up here and those that did not come up here that are in desperate need to be up in this altar right now. Father, we just thank you right now in your goodness and your mercy that you touch them and that you break the yokes. You break the yokes of bondages off of their life. And you set them free in Jesus' name. Set them free in Jesus' name. Thank you, Father, for the rivers of living water flowing out in this place right now. I thank you, Father God, as we lift our hands before you, Father, you begin to meet every need. You begin to meet every need because your people, Father, take a hold. They take a hold right now by the power of the Holy Spirit. They take a hold, Father, of all of heaven. They take a hold of all that you've promised them. They take a hold, Father, of all those things that you've given them. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Yokes broken. Deception broken right now in Jesus' name. Deception broken. Father, cause us to see. Cause every person in this place to see that they're in the need. They're in desperate need of the Almighty God every moment of the day. They're in desperate need of the Holy One. They're in desperate need of you, Father, to be filled up with all of heaven. In Jesus' name. We thank you, Father. We thank you, Father. Lesho la makate, lesho nana makete, deshne la masate, deshne la makete la morosoto, brandele le diakile la rasure. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Father, fill this place right now. Fill this place, Father, with your glory. Father God, cause your people to lay hold on heaven. Lay hold on you, Father, like never before. Lay hold. Lay hold on their eternal home. Lay hold on their eternal destiny. Lay hold on every spiritual thing that you have given us. Every glorious, wonderful promise, Father, you've given us. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Now in Jesus' name. Now in Jesus' name. J'ai tellement chéri.